I that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt? Who am I?
Welcome to Who Am I? With Pastor Greg Tyra of Harvest Chapel in Williamsport, Indiana. We're glad you could join us as we teach through the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. Today's lesson is one in which we know you'll be enlightened to the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's listen in to Pastor Greg as we launch today's lesson on Who Am I?
Turn in your Bibles with me to Acts chapter 3 just for a moment, and then we're going to be doing a little bit of Bible sword drills today. Today is what is typically called Palm Sunday. Now, I call it triumphal entry because Jesus made a triumphal entry on this day. They happened to throw their clothes on a donkey, and they threw palm branches on the ground, so we call it Palm Sunday, but it's the triumphal entry. Why is it significant? Well, you know, I don't know if you know the Jewish calendar, but the Jewish calendar today is in Israel is the 11th day of Nisan in the year of 5783. That's the calendar of the Jewish people. And yesterday was the 10th of Nisan. And the 10th of Nisan is the day that Jesus made a triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He come riding in on a donkey, and we're going to look at that. But why is it so significant? Well, because it was the day that the Passover lamb was picked. It was the day that they would choose the Lamb of God that would take away the sins of the world. But here in Acts chapter 3, I just want you to see quickly, it's 3 verse 11. Listen, everything in the early church, every sermon ever taught was about the resurrection. Listen, Resurrection Sunday is next week. And I want you to understand, and I say Resurrection Sunday, people get frustrated with me, and they like to call it Easter, but Easter is from Ishtar. It's a false fertility god. It was something that was made up to do what? To cover the resurrection of Jesus Christ. See, because the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the evidence that he was the Lamb of God that took away the sins of the world. And when you cover up the resurrection, you're covering up the truth of God. When you teach Easter, and many churches will, it's teaching falsehood to our children. It's teaching false things that just perpetrate a lie. Listen to me. Resurrection Sunday, they want to hide the resurrection. It's what the early church talked about in every sermon. It means a standing up again. Or, here it is, a recovery of spiritual truth. And what did we recover? They were apostate. They were lost. They had walked away from God. And in Christ, who preached the kingdom of God, he comes and they have a recovery by the Spirit of God of spiritual truth and how they were supposed to live. And when we come to salvation, we have a recovery of spiritual truth. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we now have spiritual eyes to see what God would say to the church. And I would encourage you, listen, in fact, let's just stop and pray. Father, we want to pray right now that if we've quenched and grieved and insulted and lied to the Holy Spirit by the way we live and the witness that we've given, that you would forgive us. And that you would open our eyes this morning to see the spiritual truth of the scriptures and then go tell somebody. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, we go out and live any way we want and we grieve and quench and insult and lie to the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit doesn't reveal truth to us. And so we pretend and we live a life of a lie. And the resurrected life is not there. us standing up again and recovering spiritual truth is not there. And it's so important that we understand that our very witness is the proof of the resurrection. And they want to cover it up. And the devil wants you to cover it up. He wants us not to be witnesses to the power of resurrection in our lives. Listen to, I want you to see this. Well, where does it come from? How do we get it? What's going on? If you were in chapter 3 of Acts with me right now, to give you some background, Peter and John, at the hour of prayer, they go into the temple at Solomon's porch. We talked about this, I think, last week, potentially. And there's a blind man begging alms. And this man was there when Jesus was walking in here days before. He's there every day begging alms. It's how he survives. Did I say a blind man or a lame man? It's a lame man. And Peter fixes his eyes upon him and says, "Look at me." He says, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise and walk." And the man stood up. And he began to walk. And that's what happens when we look at Jesus Christ. We stand up and we begin to walk out this life and live this life for Christ, because there's resurrection in our life. We've stood up again. We've recovered spiritual truth, and our legs are no longer lame. Our legs are no longer limp, but we can start to walk this out by His power for His glory. But look what it says happened. In fellowship, in life, verse 11, I'm just going to read this quickly. I'm not going to spend much time here. Like I said, Bible sword drills. "Now the lame man who was healed held on to Peter and John. All the people ran together to the porch, which is called Solomon's, greatly amazed." Listen, when people are healed, it should amaze other people. It should be a witness of the power of God when we begin to walk for God. "So when Peter saw it, he responded to the people, 'Men of Israel, why do you marvel at this? Or why look so intently at us as though by our own power or godliness we had made this man to walk?'" Listen, instantly get the attention off of yourself. "The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified His servant Jesus, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go." Pilate said 7 times, "He's an innocent man." Listen to me. He got the attention off of himself and instantly pointed it to Jesus, where it needs to be. "But you denied the Holy One and the just and asked for a murderer to be granted to you." We'll talk about that later. The murderer's name was Barabbas. Barabbas means son of the father. So they chose the wrong son of the father. "You wanted the murderer to be granted to you because he was more familiar with you, and killed the Prince of Life, the Chief of Life, the Head of Life, whom God raised from the dead." Notice how many times it's in this text. This is the sermon that you want to understand. Every sermon in the book of Acts, what's it so important about? It's the acts of the Holy Spirit through the apostles. The acts of the Holy Spirit through the church, the acts of the Holy Spirit as we're led by the Spirit of God, and that proves that we are children of God, and that's the witness of a resurrected life, that we're no longer dead and in the grave, but we're now living for Christ. 15, "and killed the Prince of Life, whom God raised from the dead, of which we are witnesses," martyrs, those who give their life. 16, "and His name," notice his name, His character, His nature, His will, His authority, "through faith in His name," where's your faith placed at? This is the context, "has made this man strong," or whole, "whom you see and know. Yes, the faith which comes through him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all." He's from Kentucky. Yet now, brethren, I know that you did it in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But those things which God foretold, how did he foretell them? By the mouth of the prophets, his prophets. Where did he tell them? In the Old Testament, the Bible, that the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed of God would suffer. He, God, has thus fulfilled. What should we do then? Verse 19. I read all of this to get you this. I want you to see the resurrection. But what's the first word given? Change your mind. Metanoia. Change your direction. Stop following the world and follow God. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing, that's a recovery of breath, breath of life, may come. Where does it come from, Greg? From the presence of the Lord. From the presence of the Lord. Why? And that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the times of restoration of all things. That's what God's doing right now. He's restoring all things that choose to be restored, which God has spoken by the mouth of all of his prophets since the world began. That's why we need spiritual eyes to know what God has been saying in the Old Testament. For Moses truly said to the fathers, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. Him you shall hear. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Him you shall hear in all things, whatever he says to you. And it shall be. Here's the result. Here's the fruit. Here's the evidence. Here's what happens when you hear. And it shall be that every soul who will not hear that prophet shall be utterly destroyed from among the people. Yes, and all the prophets from Samuel and those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold these days. You are sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your seed, notice it's not seeds, it's speaking of Jesus, the Messiah, the one who's just raised from the dead, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. To you first, the Jews, which is his audience at this time, the early church was all Jews. To you first, Paul says in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation, for the Jew first and then to the Greek, or then to the Gentile. For you, to you first, God having raised, there it is again, up his servant Jesus, resurrection, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from your sins, from your iniquities. Chapter 4. Now as they spoke to the people, the priest, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And then they arrest them. They laid hands on them. Listen, what are they disturbed about? They are greatly disturbed that they're preaching in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. That's what the devil is disturbed about. The resurrection, the evidence that Jesus was the Mashiach, the Messiah of God. And that he came into Jerusalem on the 10th in the Nisan. And then they watched him. They questioned him. They talked to him to make sure and say, oh, tell us the truth. Are you the Messiah? We just covered it in John chapter 10 as we closed out last week. And then on the 14th in the Nisan at twilight, they crucified him. And then on the 17th in the Nisan, he got up from the grave. He rose again. And what did he do then, Greg? He went to his disciples, to those who had ears to hear and eyes to see. And he began to speak to them again for 40 days. The number of judgment, things pertaining to the kingdom of God. He wanted to continue to instruct him. Listen to me. when we come to salvation and then we're baptized into the Spirit, into the body of Christ, we receive the Spirit of God. And Christ is the Spirit. And He comes and lives in our heart, and He wants to open blind eyes, and He wants us to come and build a love relationship, and He wants us to prepare us for the wedding supper of the Lamb. He's coming again soon. The times of restoration we just read about are almost finished. We're at the end of the age. Look at Colossians. I'm going to start in chapter 2. Colossians 2, verse 11. As Paul writes to the church in Colossae, he's talking about Jesus. I can't do the whole book. I'm sorry. Don't be deceived by philosophy or empty deceit according to the tradition of man, according to the basic principles of this world. For we are complete in Him who is the head of all principality and power. We're complete in Christ. Verse 2:11, in Him, in Christ, listen, you were is who you are, circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. It's a spiritual circumcision by putting off the body of sins of the flesh. Christ cuts away the flesh, cuts away the sins. He takes the power from your flesh by the circumcision of Christ, verse 12, buried with Him in baptism, watery grave, in which you also were raised with Him, resurrection, through faith in the working of God. This is what God is working out in us, who raised Him from the dead, resurrection again, and you, me and you, being dead in your trespasses and sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, your sin nature, He made alive together with Him, having forgiven you all your trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, the law, which was contrary to us, we couldn't keep it, and He has taken it out of the way, fulfilled it, having nailed it to the cross. What did that do, Greg? It disarmed principalities and powers, a spiritual host of wickedness that can accuse you, because now we're innocent. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. The triumphal day that He comes in, we call Palm Sunday, is God coming in on the 10th of Nisan to triumph over the grave. For this purpose He came, to be the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Listen, now a big comma. Because 16 says, so let no one judge you. So, because of this, it could be a therefore. Skip all of that so, which interrupts the thought, and go to chapter 3, verse 1. Listen, He triumphed over them in it. And then He says, if then you were raised, resurrection from the dead with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. How do I seek Him? Set your mind on things above, not on things on the earth. Why? For you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Wow. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Somehow, supernaturally, we died, and then we were resurrected with Him. And now we're seated in heavenly places, but now He's living through us. Do you get this? By the power of the Holy Spirit. And now we have to put to death the deeds of the flesh. And that's what He goes on to say. Therefore, put to death your members. Die to self. Deny self. Take up our cross daily and remind yourself that we're dead. We're here with a mission for the reconciliation of souls. Not to get caught up in the physical that we must walk in. We're in it. But we know it's all about the spiritual, and we do not want to get rid of the resurrection. Listen, we've been raised because He was raised. Soon there's going to be a resurrection of the dead and a resurrection of the living. Which resurrection will you rise in? The resurrection of the dead will go to hellfire. The resurrection of the living will be with Christ forever in eternity. the 10th in Nisan yesterday on the Jewish calendar. Today it's what the church, the Protestant church, celebrates that we cover up by calling it Palm Sunday instead of triumphal entry that Christ makes and the people choose him as the Messiah. Well, where does it get its start at, Greg? Well, it gets its start in the Old Testament, which is where we're going now, to Exodus chapter 12. Because it's so important to understand that when the Spirit comes in, the Spirit begins to teach you spiritual truth. I should not have to really teach this Bible. As I read it, if I would just read it out loud, the Spirit of God would open up your eyes and you would go, wow, that's in the Old Testament? Because it's the Spirit that teaches us, not me. It's the Spirit that gifts us, not me. It's the Spirit that's leading us, not me. So we want to get the attention back on Jesus, the one who was crucified and sent his Spirit to restore us until the time of restoration of all things. Are you being restored or are you still living with dead men's bones? You out of the grave, or are you still following a dead culture that makes up things to cover up resurrection? We do not have to be pit dwellers. We can go out in the power of God and be witnesses to this mighty work that he has done, where God became flesh. God come to earth and took flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And how do we know it happened? Because the prophets foretold it. The Old Testament has hidden it, but prefigures it. And Exodus 12 is just that. Exodus 12 is the Passover festival, which the people of God, the Jews, were told to celebrate every year. And they were told how to do it. We're going to see that. And Jesus is the fulfillment of the Passover festival. Everything in the Old Testament looks forward to Christ. It prefigures Christ. It keeps our New Testament doctrine in place. It outlines it, and you can go back and ask the Holy Spirit, and he will teach you what is there. He's not trying to hide it. We're his friends. He wants us to see it. He wants us to walk in it. He wants us to know it and go out with power because of who he is and what he's done. And on the 10th of Nisan is when it began, when they were in bondage in Egypt. You guys remember that? What did God do? He already made a difference when he brought his people down through Joseph. He put them in Goshen. And in Goshen, it's separated from the world. And Goshen means drawing near. Well, who were they drawing near to? They were drawing near to God and separated from the world. Listen, we are to separate from the world and draw near to God and let him finish the work and deliver us out of the world. He takes his people out of the world, and then he takes the world out of his people. It's the sanctification process. He took the children of Israel out of Egypt, and then he began in the wilderness for 40 years to take Egypt out of the people, because they still wanted to practice everything that they learned. In fact, 38 years into it, they said, oh, that we were back in Egypt where we could eat garlics and leeks and onions and we could enjoy at least having a meal. And they had ignored God. And that's why they don't enter into his rest that we talked about last week. So here in this, I have to go quickly. Exodus 12 is the 10th plague is getting ready to come upon Pharaoh. Pharaoh, remember, is a type of Satan. Egypt is a type of the world. Pharaoh's the one world government, the head of everything at the time. And God has already brought 9 plagues upon them. 9 plagues upon them, where they kept saying, oh, we'll let your children go, and then they wouldn't. Oh, we'll let them go, but then they wouldn't. And God says he's going to bring the final plague here. And it's the death of the firstborn. Listen to me. And why is that significant? Because the firstborn in Egypt were made priests. They were the leaders. They were the heads. They were the one calling the shots under Pharaoh. And they had 3,000 temples and 1,000 priests. Or excuse me, very verse. 1,000 temples and 3,000 priests. All the firstborn dedicated to propagating the lies of the false gods. And God said, I am. What do you mean? Well, he said, let my people go. And then he killed every single priest, every single leader, every single head that was trying to be on the throne in power. We see it prefigured now. They got a plan that they perfected, but God is laughing at them because one day soon, in the Battle of Armageddon, he's going to kill every one of them again because they hardened their heart. Do you know that there was a plan that was made that yesterday there was supposed to be a strike out against the United States? Now, I didn't read anything about it, but there was a thing going on the internet about there was going to be some attacks yesterday of violence. Do you know why that's significant? Because they do this stuff right out in the open. Yesterday was the 10th of Nisan. It's the day that you choose the Lamb. It's the day that you choose your Messiah. It's the day that you choose who your Father is, who you're going to trust in. And it also was April Fool's Day, just to be fair. It was April Fool's Day, which is the Bible declares the fool has said in his heart, no God. They're not going to listen to God's word. They want to kill God's word. They don't want to be part of God's kingdom. They want to be their own God. They're going to listen to the devil. Now, whether they were trying to incite people to other things or not, I don't know. But they had planned that there was going to be mass violence on the 10th of Nisan. And it's always an attack on the 10th of Nisan, especially by the ruling authorities. They're going to attack Jesus on the 10th of Nisan. They're going to tell him to tell his disciples to be quiet. And he says, if they be quiet, the rocks will cry out. Somebody's got to talk about it. It's this day, the 10th of Nisan, that the whole world was waiting for. All eyes look forward. All eyes look back. All eyes look down on the redemption of mankind. The day that the Messiah would come and he would walk in triumph and go to the cross, lay down his life, give it for the sins of the world, and then the Father would raise him from the grave again and defeat death, and there'd be no victory of the grave for those who believe in Christ. There would be no death for sins for those who trust in God and his Messiah and look to God. And this is what this is all about. Right here, the 10th of Nisan. Let's pray. Father, open our eyes to see Jesus before it's too late. In Jesus' name and for his glory, amen. Exodus 12:1. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, one called out, and to Aaron, light bearer. See, when you're called out, you become a light bearer. Now you become a believer priest and you go out telling others. Where did he call them out? The land of Egypt. That's a world to us, saying, this month shall be the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation. Congregation is the ecclesia in the Greek. It's not that, but it's those called out of Israel. Israel's governed by God, saying on the 10th of this month, it's the 10th of Nisan or the 10th of Abib, March or April to us. It's settled by the moon. On the 10th of this month, every man, listen. Not to be offensive, but this word here is specifically for a man. It's not for a woman. It's specifically for a man. Lots of words for man mean man or woman or human being. But this is God giving the headship of authority to man. The man was supposed to do this in his family, not the woman. That's why death culture is killing men. That's why death culture destroys men. He destroys the home. He destroys marriage. That's why the devil wants to destroy authority of God in leadership, because God has given it to man. See, God created man, and then from man, he took the woman out of his side as a helpmate. And this is a message that the church doesn't even want to hear today. The church doesn't even want to hear the authority structure of God and the leadership of God and what God has done. It's not a bad message. It's a truthful message that flips everything right side up and causes a man to step up with the power of God and do the work of God for the glory of God and protect his home, to go get his children and take care of his bride. And know that God has given us power. And yes, he does give the power to the woman. And yes, he does love all of us. Because in heaven, there's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male or female. We're all spirits to God. But down here, he's put us in a body on purpose. Listen to me. He's put us in a body on purpose. It doesn't trans. It doesn't change. It's not fluid. But death culture wants to kill. And that's what was going on at this time. They were killing the children by abortion. All the males, only the males. Let the females stay alive, but kill the men. And now we're not just killing the babies and killing the men, but we're also cutting off their penises and training little bitty kids that it's okay to do that. You think it's not an evil, dark day when we see this being allowed in America and the world, and it's being trained as something that can happen, and it's against God Almighty and the Word of God? And we need to proclaim it from the rooftops, because it's from the devil. And the only way to save anybody that thinks they need to do that is tell them the truth. They need Jesus also. They're not the enemy. The devil is the enemy. Listen. On the 10th of the year, speak to all the congregation, verse 3, in the 10th of the month, every man shall take for himself a lamb according to his house of his father's. Who's your father? Where's your father's house? What lamb are you choosing? The Father in heaven sent Jesus the Messiah as the Lamb of God. It's the only one to choose. Any other lamb that doesn't line up with the Scripture's lamb, with the prophet's lamb, with what is written of the lamb, any other lamb is not of the God the Father and will not deliver you back into the house of God through marriage with your kinsman redeemer. A lamb for a household, verse 4. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and the neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons. According to each man's need, you shall make your count for the lamb. So we get a lamb that's appropriate, that's proportionate to the size of the family. And if the family's too small, we go next and share it with our neighbors, because it's a one another ministry. But our culture don't want you to talk to your neighbor. Don't be a part of your neighbor's life. But that's what the second commandment is. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. But they want you to hate your neighbor and divide you from your neighbor, because of all the rhetoric that's going on, because we don't tell truth anymore. Verse 5, your lamb shall be without blemish. Now listen, blemish is something that happens at birth. Marks and scars and other things happen as you live life, but without blemish. Born without blemish. See, we were all born with a sin nature. Jesus was born with no sin nature, no blemishes. That's what this is prefiguring and speaking of. A without blemish, a male of the first year. It can be translated in the Hebrew, firstborn or only born. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Let's look at, and I can read to you quickly, 1 Peter 1:17. Listen, 1 Peter, what does Peter declare? And if you call on the Father, are you calling on the Father in heaven? If you call on the Father who without partiality judges according to each one's works, conduct yourself. How are you living? What's your acts that the Holy Spirit are leading you to do throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct? See, before when we were in our sin nature, it was aimless. Now we have specific, deliberate actions that we should be doing because we're part of a body that gives us perfect instruction, perfect authority, perfect power, perfect redemption. He gives us gifts and we should be walking in them. Not aimlessly going, if I fall into this, I can't listen. It's your soul. If you're still living aimlessly, you're not listening to the Holy Spirit or getting into the Word of God deliberately. If I hit it, I might. If I don't, I won't. Listen, it's a target that was hit every time by Jesus the Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We're aiming at something. We're aiming at being deliberate about the salvation of souls. We're not going to continue from your aimless conduct received by the tradition from your fathers, small f, from other men who weren't living from Jesus, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb, as of a lamb, without blemish, without spot. See, spot is what happens as you live. Blemish is how you're born. All of us have blemishes. Spots is what happens when you get scars and marks and you go act out your sin nature. Listen, Jesus without blemish, and then he lived a perfect life, no spot. And his blood was accepted by the Father. And because it was accepted, we have Resurrection Day. He got up out of the grave, the evidence that he was without blemish, he without spot. He fulfilled the scriptures that were written that they look forward to as they celebrated the Passover every year. And it started on the 14th in the Psalm, which is actually when he was crucified at twilight. And then it lasted for 7 days. We'll see that in a minute. Let me get back to this. Verse 20. He indeed was foreordained before the foundation of the world. God had this plan. It's not a new plan. It's not plan B. There's only one plan. There's only one God, only one Messiah coming, but was manifest in these last times for you. In other words, it was uncovered, made apparent by the power of the Holy Spirit, who through him believed in God, who raised resurrection him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Is that where you're placing it today? Are you looking forward to his glorious appearing? Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth. Listen, when you believe that Jesus is Lord and God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. That's obeying the truth. That's the starting line. Now we learn to observe and obey and tell others about it for the rest of our life. We're sanctified positionally, but practically it's going on. Through what? The Spirit of God. As many as are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. In sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the Word of God, the living Word of God, through Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God, which lives and abides forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away, Jesus said. Because, he quotes scripture, Peter does, all flesh is as grass. Getting ready to start mowing it again. And all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. Anything it produces, all of our glory is going to be burned up. The grass withers and its flower falls away. But the word of the Lord, what? Stands. It endures forever. And you and I have need of endurance. And it only comes from the power of God, by the Spirit of God, in the Word of God, because we know the truth of God. You're not going to get endurance chasing the world and living in the world. You're only going to get it as you surrender to God. Now, this is the word which they, by the gospel, was preached to you. Same thing that Paul said to the church in Colossae. Therefore, put to death the deeds of the flesh. Chapter 2 is, therefore, lay aside the deeds of the flesh. We have to begin to deliberately say, I want to lay these things aside, to stop practicing this and begin practicing this. Listen, you know what your heart is? It's so easy to be trained. That's why we train children when they're little kids in the way that they should go. But if you let them teach themselves, if you let them be left to themselves, they're going to become a disgrace to you. Listen, your heart is so easily trained. I look at my wife and I go, oh my goodness. Breaks my heart. She's got a feeding tube. She can't eat, but she's always been a cook and a hospitality and always made new meals and food and entertained 50 and 60. And I see my wife, who can no longer eat with her mouth, on all the new food networks still, because her heart has been trained to always be there. She's got subscriptions to them, and she's talking about what she's going to make for me to eat, and her heart can't just go away from it because it's been trained in this way. What are you training your heart for? Which father are you looking at? Is the word of God washing and cleansing and purifying you? Is your heart being trained by the world? Listen, the tenth in the psalm is very important, but it's the 17th in the psalm that they want to kill, the resurrection. They want to kill your witness and your resurrection, that you're going to get up. They won't want you to finish well. They want you to die and be quiet and never speak because of all your life being afraid of death. Listen, Christ took our death. It has no sting. Hades has no victory. But how sad it is when a church will not speak up that their hope is in Christ Jesus, because they're still afraid of what man can do to them. And man can't do anything but kill the body. God can kill the body and cast the soul into hell. And yet I digress. And it's all about and pointed from God, from a lamb without blemish, without spot, that we've been purchased by the precious blood of Jesus, as we digress and go back to the Passover festival in Exodus 12. Powerful stuff. Remember, that was verse 5. Now, what should we do? Verse 6, man, 6. Now, you shall keep guard protected until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel, those governed by God, all in unity, shall kill it at twilight. He came and died for us. And remember, it was dark. The whole earth went dark for 3 hours when he hung on the cross. And he said, Tetelestai, it is finished. We'll talk a little bit more about that next week, probably, God willing. 7, and they shall take some of the blood and put it on the 2 doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it, where you're having a fellowship meal because you're eating the Lamb of God. Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if any man will hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. When you're born again, you begin to apply the blood to your heart. All the resources of heaven, the inheritance, come through the blood. Life is in the blood. 8, new beginning, they shall eat the flesh on that night. You'll see this is sanctification. It's a destruction of the flesh in this dark world. We come out from among them, roasted in fire. God is a consuming fire. He burns up the flesh with unleavened bread. Unleavened bread has no yeast in it, which yeast is a type of, or a form of, or points to evil influence in the church. Fire burns that out. Jesus is the bread of life. We're eating of him where there is no sin. And with bitter herbs they shall eat it. And bitter herbs is suffering. Through much suffering shall we enter the kingdom of God. Bitter herbs will remind us that things are not always going to be sweet. But God is still on the throne. We're still having fellowship and resting in him and partaking of a meal with him, because it's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And we can rest even in suffering, which is coming soon to a city near you. but God's fire. Verse 9, listen, you can't do it any other way. Do not eat it raw. Can't do it any other way. You have to have the fire. Nor boiled at all with water, but roasted in fire. Has to be fire. And you know, soon, listen to me, soon, final judgment's going to be fire. We just read about it in Josiah reforms. 2 Kings 23, Josiah is a type. He burns up everything. And he pours dead man bones on top and makes everything that's been living unclean, unclean for real. Reaping what they sow. Roasted in fire. It's coming soon. Where God's going to burn up everything. Listen, not just the world and not just judgment, not just cast into hell fire, but everything that's in a believer's life is going to go to the Bema Seat judgment. And if it wasn't done for the glory of God, under the Spirit of God, He's going to burn it up out of your life. And then you'll enter into heaven yet as though by fire. Because nothing can come into heaven that's of man's religions and man's works. So you can't even get up there unless you go through fire. And that's what he's saying here. Its head is power, with its legs, its walk, and its entrails. That's every bit. Your body, soul, and spirit is going to be sanctified. Everything about you, inside, outside, your life is going to be roasted with fire, and it will be finished, and you'll be like him when we get there. 10. Final completion. You shall let none of it remain until morning, the new day. And what remains of it until morning, you shall burn with fire. That's how he's going to get rid of all of it. This is the Bema Seat. 11. And thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Listen, deliberately, with the belt of truth on. Listen, that's the belt of truth. Did you guys see it? The belt on your waist, sandals on your feet. Truth and your feet are prepared by the preparation of the gospel of peace. That's what we're supposed to be doing. We are living in truth and we're going out and telling people about truth as we allow him to sanctify and cleanse us. As we sup with him and have a meal with him and fellowship with him, we're going out and we have our staff in our hand. And we eat it in haste. It's the Lord's Passover. It all belongs to the Lord. For I will pass through the land. This is what God says. I will pass through the land of Egypt, the world, in that night when it's dark, and will strike all the firstborn of the land of Egypt, all the priests, all the leaders, all the heads, all those who are out there indoctrinating children, all those that are out there indoctrinating a lie, they will be struck. They need to repent. Because God's going to kill them. Firstborn. Born of man, born of beast, and against, notice who it's against, their gods, their false gods of Egypt, of the land. I will execute judgment. Why? I am the Lord. Now the blood shall be a sign. The blood shall be a sign. You know, this word is used one time as mark. The blood shall be a sign. It was really interesting. It's in Genesis 4:15. It's used one time as a mark, where God put a mark on Cain. That's pretty interesting. It shall be a sign. It's token in the King James as an oath. It's a flag. It's a banner. It's a monument. Oh, wait a minute. It's evidence. It's the evidence. The blood is the evidence for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I, God, death angel, will pass over you. Hence the name of the festival, pass over you. I will recognize you by your following my word, by you obeying what I've said to do, by the presence of the Holy Spirit. And the plague means a trip of foot, an infliction of disease, or it's a blow, but it means a fatal blow. The fatal blow shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt, when I strike the world. Why? Because the blood of Jesus, the Lamb of God, without blemish or spot, that we've been purchased with. 14, so this day shall be to you a memorial, a remembrance. It's Independence Day from your sin, their Independence Day from Egypt. And you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from those governed by God, from those in Israel. Now listen, because this all started in 14, and it all starts on the 14th in Nisan. God is so perfect in his order and his decisiveness that you don't have to miss these things. Listen to me. 10th, you pick the lamb. You got him in the house like a dog that we would call, an animal that's familiar with. You're looking at him. You're making sure there's no blemishes. It's not too much for you, or you're going to get some help from your neighbors and share with your neighbors. And then on the 14th, after you become familiar with that lamb, you're going to have to kill it. Can anybody imagine right now going home and going, hey, my dog's name's Zoe, which means life or eternal life. I'm just going to have to kill you today. I'm familiar with you, and cut its throat and sacrifice it. And that's what was the part was, is that they become familiar. It become relational. This is the lamb they're taking care of. They're tending to their, and that's what we're supposed to be doing with Jesus. But we're reminded that he died for us. So he's altogether separate from us, yet he wants us to be with him and part of him. But what do we have to do, Greg? Well, he just told us. We want to keep this feast. We want to remember it. It just so happens in the last night of his life, and we'll get to it probably next week. What did he do? Supper being ended. This Passover supper was ended. He instituted communion for the church. The Passover is for the Jewish nation. They still celebrate it. They're celebrating. This is Passover week to them, not to the church. The church is celebrating co-union with God because of his death, burial, and resurrection. It's the nation of Israel still celebrates Passover because they're still waiting. They're still looking forward. They denied the just one. They don't believe in him. And that's not all of them. There's Messianic Jews. But Christ is my Passover. I'm not going to die because of Christ. Oh, I might die in this physical body, but my spirit's going to be with him forever. That's what Paul was reminding them of in Thessalonians when they were going, hey, our loved ones have died, and what's going to happen? Christ isn't back yet. And he says, I do not want you to be ignorant. Listen, he doesn't want us to be ignorant of anything. It means unlearned. I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep. Euphemism for dead. For the dead in Christ will rise first, and then those who are alive and remain will meet the Lord in the air, and thus will be with him always. And we're to encourage one another with these words. He says, "With the trump will sound, the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will rise, harpazo, raptured, taken out, and thus will be with the Lord always." And we're to encourage one another with these words. Just as they're getting ready to be taken out with this death of the firstborn. Now listen, because if you go and read the text, I'm not going to be there because we got way too much material. But on the 10th, they chose. Then they became friends, and they checked it out, and they enjoyed it, and they had fellowship and friendship. And then on the 14th, it died, and its blood was put on their doorposts. And then it passed over, and guess what? On the 15th, they went out by their tribes. On the 15th, they left. As a type of rapture, they were gone. But what happened? The enemy pursued them because this is a physical, tangible. The enemy pursued them and said, what have I done? I've let them get away. But the enemy had no more power over them. And the Lord vanquished him and killed him. destroyed every one of Pharaoh's army, all of them, in the Red Sea. Remember, he killed everything with a flood. He promised never to do that again. But once again, he's going to kill all things that are against him, the enemies of the cross. He'll do it with fire. First, in the Valley of Jezreel, at the Battle of Armageddon, they're going to be joined together to fight each other. And then Christ is going to bust the clouds open. He's going to come on a white horse. And the blood will be up to the bridle as he kills all the enemies of the cross. It's important because we're going to see here in a minute, Matthew 21, when we go there, he comes on a donkey. He comes on a colt, the foal of a donkey. He comes on a newborn foal. He doesn't come on a white horse like a king does. His first time he came as a suffering servant. His first time he came as the Lamb of God. His first time he came on a beast of burden on the 10th of Nisan. And then he was crucified as the anointed of God on the 14th. And then he got up on the 17th. Resurrection. It's just standing up again from death. He came and took our death so that we can stand up again and we can have a recovery of spiritual truth. And boy, how bad am I at following it. But I stand in Christ Jesus, not in my own works. I stand in his finished works on the cross. So I go out with boldness to tell others about it because of who he is, not who I am. Don't look at me or look at his people. Point to Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes the sins of the world. But what were we supposed to do? 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. 7 is the number of completion. He's making us whole. We're supposed to be looking to take all the leaven on the first day. You shall remove leaven from your houses. Remember, it's the influence of evil. Dads, men, are you cleaning up your houses? How's it getting into your kids? Oh, through the schools, through the TV, through the music, through the phones. How's it getting to your kids? As dads, as men, we're supposed to be cleaning up our houses. And I understand there's single mom families out there. That's my neighbor. Men should be helping single family moms. The church should be there, not the government. The government wants to deceive them. So we're supposed to be removing the leaven from our homes. And if we're not moving in that direction, it means that we're not walking with the power of the Spirit. And it says you'll be cut off from those who are governed by God. That's what it says. And you can say it's the Old Testament, but my God doesn't change. Evidence, moving forward. That's what sheep do. They are moving forward, four-footed animals that move forward, not backward. On the first day, there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day, there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only may be prepared for you. Now listen, what's that speaking of? That's speaking of you can't do this with your own works. You have to rest in Christ. And everything that he's done on the cross is all the finished works that are there for us. All you do is believe in that and go out and do that by the power of the Holy Spirit, what he has prepared for us. You cannot do this with your own works any of this day, any of this time that we are here. It has to be only by what everyone must eat. You're supping and you're eating on the bread of life and doing what God has said to do. 17, so you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for on the same day, what's God going to do? I will have brought your armies, your tribes, out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall obey, observe this day throughout your generations as an everlasting ordinance. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month, at evening, you shall eat the unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days no leavened bread shall be found in your houses, since whoever eats what is leavened, the same person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is a stranger or a native in the land. Second witness, you shall eat nothing leavened in all your dwellings. You shall eat unleavened bread. So now everything that we get, no influence of evil in it, only Jesus, the bread of life that has come down. 10th in the Psalm, 14th in the Psalm. Listen, now let's go to Matthew 21. Why is this day important? Now we're celebrating. It's actually the 11th of Nisan in Israel, according to the Jewish calendar. It's actually the 11th of Nisan. Oh, did you guys know, as you're going to Matthew 21, that if you wish to have stopped off, and you can if you want with me, if you've already got there, at Joshua 4:19. There's some interesting studies that you can do. And I found seven different things that all happened on the first month, first day. I might do that as our New Year's message if we're still here. But 4:19, what happened on the 10th of Nisan? Listen, they had believed God in the waters. The streams were flowing. It's this flood season. And the priests had to step out on the Jordan onto the water. And when they did, the waters receded. And on the 10th in the Psalm, what did they do? It says in 4:19 of Joshua, now the people came up from the Jordan on the 10th day of the first month, the month of Abib, the month of the Psalm. What does that mean? Well, Jordan means the descender. They came up out of the water. No more descending, but we're looking up. We're looking up. We're being lifted up. Resurrection. That's when it starts. And that's where we are. When you fast forward, you go to Matthew 21. Matthew 21. And we have the fulfillment beginning of the Passover festival. It couldn't be any other day. This had to happen on the 10th of Nisan because Jesus is the fulfillment of the prophecy of the Passover festival. It always looked. That's why they remembered. That's why they celebrated. It was a promise that God was going to, the same way he delivered them out of Egypt, he was going to deliver them from the sin nature, that the Messiah would come. They looked forward by faith. Now, verse 21:1. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem, teaching peace, and came to Bethpage, what does that mean, figs or something? Boy, I'm in the wrong place. Doesn't matter, we're not going to really talk about it. To Bethpage at the Mount of Olives. Wonder what they had on the Mount of Olives. You think it was olives? Olive oil? Do I even have it? Yes, found it. Bethpage means fig house, house of unripe figs. At the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples. Listen, I'm going to stop there. Don't be a lone wolf McQuaid. Don't be by yourself. Don't think I'm okay. I'm out here by myself. Jesus, the Christ, God in the flesh, sent them out in two so that they would have accountability. The devil wants to isolate you and then decimate you and destroy you. We don't teach that much in the churches anymore. Saying to them, go, that's what he said to us, into the village opposite you, I believe it's Bethany, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Only Matthew mentions both of them. It doesn't make the other evangelist or writers of the Gospels wrong. They just focus on the colt because it's Zechariah 9:9, the prophecy that it would happen. You'll find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them, and immediately he will send them. Really speaking of that, when he sends us and tells us to go, that we have his authority when we say the word of God. When we say what Jesus has said, we have authority. We go in his authority. We go in his power, but we go to speak what he has instructed and what he said, not what we want to make up. We go to speak the word of God to others, and then he takes care of it according to his will. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly, sitting on a donkey, a colt the foal of a donkey. Now, of course, that's Zechariah 9:9. 500 years earlier, it was written. I'm not going there for the sake of time. I'm moving forward quickly. A lot of context today. But this is triumphal entry. This is what's going on. And you say, triumph? He came triumphantly, but they killed him. That was the purpose he came for. To fulfill the will of God as the Lamb of God. When you fulfill what God has called you for, then you're running in triumph. You're walking in triumph. You're building endurance and triumph of God. And you're walking and standing in His victory. And you become part of that parade where He's triumphed over His enemies and He leads us in triumph. And they have to look at the spoils and see you. In the presence of your enemy, He prepares the table. And they have to see you and they can't do nothing to you unless you let them lie to you or make you afraid, which is what they love to do. Fear. He's coming back on a white horse. Right now, He's entering in humbly and giving His life for the sins of the world. And this is what they traditionally call Palm Sunday, 10th of Nisan. What happens, Greg? Look at verse 6. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. Listen to me. It's 6 on purpose. The number of man is 6. We would do well if we've chosen the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world without blemish or spot, to go and do all that He has commanded us. Listen to me. That's what we're called to do as men, as women, as the people of God, is to obey all that He's commanded us. Find out what He's saying. Find out what He's doing. Find out your gifts and talents and abilities. Be in the word, prayer, and fellowship, and be involved in the reconciliation of souls, because all authority has been given to Him. And He sends us with that word of reconciliations as ambassadors. 7, here they are, they're being sanctified. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set Him on them. They took off their clothes, and they put on Christ. Listen, that's what we're supposed to be doing. It's what He would have said in Colossians 3 if I'd have kept going. Take off the old man and put on the new man. They took off what they were clothed in. It's really their outer garment. And then they set Him on them, on the colt. And a very great multitude, there's a crowd there, spread their clothes on the road. There's others watching. There's others taking off their clothes. But are they lifting up Jesus? You know, they had to lift Him up to set Him on that donkey. They had to lift Him up to set Him up there. Are you lifting Him up or lifting up your heel against Him? They spread Him on the way, the road, and it becomes a witness. We're going to get to that in John chapter 11 with Lazarus taking off his grave clothes. Others cut down branches. This is palm branches. It's why we started calling it Palm Sunday. To me, it's one of the least things that's going on here. Why do we call it Palm Sunday? To hide the tent of Nisan. To hide what's really going on. To hide the truth of the context. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Now this is translated from the Septuagint, so we don't get it perfectly. But if you go back, and I would like for you to do that with me, he's quoting Psalms 118, 26. I want you to turn there, middle of your Bible. Psalms 118, 26. Five, we will begin with. Just lost my place. Sorry. Bible sword drills. It gets good to learn where you're going in your Bible. What are you doing? What are you finding? Where are we at? 118, 24. Now, I could give you more because this is going to go on during the week of questioning, 22 and 23. They reject the stone, the chief cornerstone. But what's 24, though? 118:24 says, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Now, we say that a lot of times because of today, but it's speaking of the day of salvation. It's speaking of the day of the tent and the sun. It's speaking of the day that he comes in triumphantly to fulfill his purpose as the Lamb of God. And then what does it say? Hosanna, Hosanna. It says, save now. That's what Hosanna means. Listen to me. Hosanna means save now. All the crowd are yelling, save now. They're choosing him as the Messiah. They're choosing him as the Lamb of God. While the other priests, you know what they're doing? They're killing all of the lambs. They're getting them ready. Well, they're not killing them yet till the 14th. They're getting them ready. They're choosing them, and they're bringing them into the temple area. And people are coming from all around, millions of people, and they're bringing their lambs, and they're in the temple, and they're exchanging their lambs because the men are lying to them and going, your lamb is not good enough. You have to buy one of our lambs. That's why we're going to see the first thing that Jesus does when he gets into the city, he goes into the temple. He makes a whip, and he scourges. And he chases them out. He turns over the tables. Righteous anger and zeal has eaten him up for his father's house. And he chases them out because the people are in there lying and cheating and deceiving the people that he came to save. But really, this is the verse that's being quoted here. Psalms 118:26, save now, I pray, O Lord. O Lord, I pray, send now prosperity. You want prosperity? Choose the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, that your soul would prosper. Choose the Word of God. What does Joshua say in Joshua 1:8? This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall observe to do according to, meditate in it day and night, and observe to do according to all that is written in it, and then you shall be prosperous, and then you shall be of good success. Prosperity and success is in the eye of God, and he wants us to be involved in the ministry of reconciliation of souls. Save now, I pray, O Lord. They're choosing the Messiah. In Matthew 21, on the 10th of Nisan, they're choosing him as the lamb that's coming to die, but they don't know he's going to die. Listen, they're choosing him at this moment, the common people, but by the end of the week, on the 24th, the Jewish leaders lie to him and stir him up, and they yell, crucify him! Why? Because he didn't save now. They didn't understand that first he had to die, and then you believe in him. And so they said, he didn't do what I wanted. I'm mad now. He didn't do what I wanted him to do. They have been falsely taught, and they still believe in Jewish culture that he only comes once. But the scriptures clearly teach that he comes as a lamb for slaughter. He comes first, and he has to die. Look, it actually says it there. It's 26, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of the Lord. 27, God is the Lord. He has given us light. Light of the world, remember? Then what does it say to do to the light of the world? Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horn of the altar. You are my God, I will praise you. You are my God, I will exalt you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. It's new every morning. Listen, the Bible is clear that he was going to be a sacrifice. The Passover festival itself that they were celebrating told them that he was going to be a sacrifice. And what did they do? They didn't get it. And they led the people to rebel against him and say, crucify him, crucify him. 4 days later, the 14th of Nisan. Back in our text, Hosanna, verse 9b, Hosanna, the son of David. Now, son of David is a messianic term. They knew that Jesus come from the loins. They knew that the Messiah come from the loins of David. God had made a promise in 1 Samuel to David. Blessed is he who comes in the name, according to the character, the nature, the will of the Lord. Because this is what he was born for, to be the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? How do you answer that? Who is this? Who is this God who would come and take flesh and would allow his own creation to crucify him, knowing, if you remember when he institutes communion, he says he gives thanks for it, knowing that he's getting ready to go out of the upper room. I can't wait to get to chapter 13 of John. Out of the upper room, he's going to go through lower Jerusalem, chapter 14, across the brook Kidron, 15, into the Garden of Gethsemane, where he's going to be met with a detachment of troops, Judas leading them. Judas bought and paid for by the governing authorities, the heads, the priest, those that hate him, the enemies of the cross. He's going to be betrayed with a kiss because they couldn't recognize him. There was no comeliness about him. It was his words that changed people's life. Listen to me. They would need nobody to sell him out. They needed nobody to point him out in the garden if they knew who he was. He could blend into the crowd. There was no comeliness. There's nothing when you look at him. He was just like everybody else. But it was his words. It was his words that give life. It's his words that the devil wants to kill. It's his word that's his authority and his nature and his character. It's his word that will live forever. And heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. Not one jot or tittle. It's living. It's powerful. It's alive. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's able to divide the bone and the marrow and the soul and the spirit. And it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. How we're living, where we're going, who we're choosing, why we make the decisions we make. It will lead us to bear fruit. It will lead us in triumph. If we put it first and give it its place, it will complete the work it started until the day of Christ Jesus. It will sanctify and cleanse us. In John 17, Jesus says, sanctify them with truth. Your word is truth. That's how we're set apart to do thy will, O God. Who do you say he is? Who is this that would cause such a stir in all nations, in the whole world, in all places? They hate Jesus. And they want to kill his word. They want to destroy what he has said because he has spoken life to us. And if they hated him, they'll hate us. But they hate us because of who he is in us and through us. Who do you say he is? Who is this? So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee, the heathen circle. And people just can't take a prophet, a Messiah that comes from such lowly places. Give them a hero from Hollywood. Give them a sports hero. Give them some pope. Give them somebody that looks like they're somebody. But what about lowly, humble, obeying a father, riding a donkey, laying down his life, allowing him to beat him? You know that they're going to arrest him. They're going to spit on him. They're going to mock him. They're going to take him to Caiaphas and then to Annas. Then they're going to take him and deliver him over to Pilate and ask Herod. And then they're going to put him up on a block and they're going to yell, crucify him. And they're going to choose Barabbas, the son of the father of hell, the father of lies, that they know for a fact is a murderer. They know he's a murderer. Listen to me, church. Listen to me, you who say you know Jesus. Listen, if we have the Spirit of God, we know every man is a murderer. Every man is born with a sin nature just like ours. Every man, except for the God man. So don't listen to man. Be led by the Spirit of God into the Word of God for the glory of God. And if other men are following that pattern, follow them. Be a part of them. Put your gifts in with them. Be a part of that. But flee from anything else. He's a thief and a robber. And that's what's coming, to steal and kill and destroy really soon. Those who do not want to learn the Word of God and be led by the Spirit of God. Don't wait. Don't act like I can do it tomorrow. Aim at it today. Cry out today. He's a prophet from Nazareth. Nothing there except an army. In the heathen circle, he's going to take our punishment. 39 lashes. How many times? Why 39? Why does the Old Testament have 39? Why did Josiah die at 39? Because 40 is the judgment. He doesn't want you to get to 40. He takes it for you. They wouldn't give anybody more than 39 lashes because they didn't want them to die at the 40th lash. So just like the festival, chapter 21 continues. He goes in and cleanses the temple. Your title might say again in 12 through 17. Then he goes back out to Bethany. And then he's speaking with his disciples. Then he's going to be questioned. There's going to be a week of questioning. He does some parables. It's not in here. The religious leaders come to him, questioning him. They're trying to find out, tell us plainly if you're the Messiah. But there's a whole week, 4 days, 10th and Nisan to the 14th and Nisan. Remember, their day started at 6 at night and ended at 6 at the next night, twilight. Chapter 26:1, we're told that it came to pass. Don't you just love it that everything that's in the Word of God is going to come to pass? Well, what's next, Greg? Read the Word of God. Study the Word of God. Cry out to Him now. Just be in Him. If you can't learn the Word of God in time, know that you're right with Him today. Ask Him to forgive you today. Confess your sins today. Ask the Holy Spirit to wash and cleanse you today. One prayer is all it takes. Today is the day for salvation. Salvation is a continuing thing. He tells them in 26:1, there's 2 days to the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. And then we're told that they were plotting, even as he's speaking about it. He knew exactly what was going on. He knows exactly what's going on right now on planet Earth. Everything. Nothing is out of his sight. Listen to me. He knows they're plotting, they're planning. We don't. We sit around and we pass articles back and forth and we talk about things and we talk about men and we should be lifting up Jesus. These men are nothing. If they don't get saved, they're going to burn in hell that's trying to take over our planet. But what are they doing? They're trying to destroy God's creation. The creation that Christ came and died and, yea, rose again on the third day to save. They're trying to change their DNA with mRNA. They're trying to destroy the man, male and female, that God created them. They're trying to completely destroy what God has done in creation and have their own little utopia without God. No God, they would say. It's really interesting to me, though, that that day came on April Fool's Day this year. I don't know what it means. God does. I'm not worried about it. He's outside of time. But are we worried about souls? They're going to crucify him. He's going to go to the upper room, celebrate the final Passover. He's going to break bread, give it to Judas. Judas is going to go out. He's going to say to Judas, "What you do, do quickly." He's going to go out, and it's going to be dark in his life forever. He's going to betray the Lord and Savior. I think we'll pick up on it next week. Listen, today is triumphal entry. Next week is Resurrection Sunday. Don't be afraid to change what we've always said, to repent and turn and stop saying Palm Sunday. Stop saying Easter. I'm not saying you have to. You're not going to hell for saying words. We're going to hell if we go to hell for denying God, for saying no to God, for not believing God, for not following God. We're saved by grace. God's already given us this great salvation. Why don't we enjoy it? Why don't we walk in it? Why don't we tell others about it? Why don't we rest in the finished work that the blood of Jesus has given us? All the riches of the heavenlies. Don't hide the evidence. Don't hide the evidence. You hear me? Don't hide the evidence that Jesus got up. And we have a recovery of spiritual truth. And that because of that recovery in the spirit in you, now we're going to get up. And we're going to proclaim the light of the world to others. Not just today, but every day. Because of the ministry of reconciliation of souls. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you wrote it down as examples for us to learn from. Thank you for giving us your spirit to have eyes to see it, to glean it, to hand it out to others, to digest it, to go out with boldness and to share it. Thank you for your son Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Pour out your spirit upon us, Lord. Give us a desire to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I commanded you. And lo, you are with us always, even to the end of the age. Thank you for such great, precious, and true promises. Even so, we pray, come quickly, Lord Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you.
And that concludes today's message on Who Am I? With Pastor Greg Tyra of Harvest Chapel in Williamsport, Indiana. If you're in the area, we would love to have you as our guest. Harvest Chapel is located at 418 Old State Road 28, Williamsport, Indiana, 47993. We meet for worship on Sundays at 10 a.m. Our prayer meetings meet Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Our Bible study meets on Friday at 7 p.m. Today's and previous messages are available on CD. If you would like a copy, please call 765-404-7203. We look forward to seeing you again next time on Who Am I?
Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I